Webinar, Perspectives of Indian Women from Medieval to Colonial Time, organized by the Department of History and IQAC, Surendranath Evening College. I am Debopriyo Shannal, coordinator of IQAC, and I take great pleasure welcoming two very eminent scholars from the discipline, Dr. Amit Dey, Professor, Department of History, Calcutta, and Dr. Aparna Bandyopadhyay, Associate Professor, Women's University. I also welcome the faculty members from other colleges present here today. I welcome Honorable President of the Governing Body of the College, Dr. Sundanath Basu. I welcome the teacher in charge of our college, Sushi Chamaroy, and other faculty members, particularly the teachers of the History Department, Srimati Manjuri Chakraborty, Srimati Sudipa Sindhu, Srimati Momita Dasgupta, and Sri Amlan Mondol. Before beginning the webinar proper, I'd like to request the Honorable President of the Governing Body to say a few words. Dr. Ruthindranath Basu, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. It's clear. You are audible.
Fine. Very good afternoon. On behalf of the Governing Body of Surendranath College, I warmly welcome our honored resource persons in this one-day state-level webinar program on perspective of Indian women from medieval to colonial period. I would like to say that the topic of this one-day state-level webinar is perfectly aligned, just in time, and crying need of the hour to acknowledge the fact that from time immemorial, Indian women has been playing a very significant pivotal role and contribution in all aspects of social development and socio-economic transformation. Historically and really, women human resources has been considered as potential energy for human development across the globe. So I strongly believe that this webinar will definitely focus some positive energy with fruitful suggestions and recommendation to the universal cause of the global humanity. Once again, I would like to welcome and thank Professor Dr. Amit Dey of University of Calcutta and Professor Dr. Aparna Bandyopadhyay, who out of Diamond Harbor Women University, who out of their busy schedule came forward to show some light in making this August webinar successful. I also thank our ex officio secretary of the governing body, Professor Supti Saharoy, and convener of this program, Professor Manjuri Chakraborty, head of the Department of History, Surendranath Evening College. I also congratulate our IQAC coordinator, Professor Debopriyo Shannal, and all the teaching fraternity in the Department of History, Professor Sudipa Chaudhary, Professor Amlan Mondol, Professor Momita Dasgupta, and finally, a lot of thanks to technical support team, Professor Abiri Guha and Professor Himadrinath Shaha, HOD Department of Computer Science, and all the teaching and supporting staff of this esteemed institution for organizing this program. Thank you very much and hope for the best, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I'll begin this webinar, but a little bit of a cueing to the topic and the theme of what we shall be talking about. And after that, I'll be yielding the floor to our first speaker. So this webinar is something which is situated at the interface of history and feminism. And after the first, second, and third waves of feminism from Europe and America, historians all over the world incorporated and creatively researched on how women and women's history can be brought to the forefront, a position which it did not enjoy before. From Mary Wollstonecraft to Simone de Beauvoir to Judith Butler, Gayatri Spivak, and the Bolton historians, the journey has been long and interesting and contested. Mainstream history has neglected women and excluded them as silent voices of history. One of the main reasons for this has been its privileging of the public world of men. Traditional history has tended to focus on areas of human activity in which men are dominant. Politics, wars, diplomacy, areas in which women have little or no role. Against this backdrop, where women have been largely erased, how have historians retrieved them and restored them with a proper perspective? We have two brilliant scholars to talk about all this today. We shall be knowing about the discourse of women in the purview of Islam, as well as the intimate history of them in colonial Bengal. So I now welcome our very first speaker, Dr. Omit De, to deliver the first lecture. Before that, I wish to briefly introduce him, though his CV is so brilliant that a brief introduction won't happen, I think. Dr. Omit De is a professor of history in the Department of History, Center for Advanced Studies, University of Kolkata. And he was the ex-HOD of the department. At present, he is also the MPhil coordinator of the university. He received a PhD degree in history in September 1999 from the University of London for his work on the image of the Prophet in Bengali Muslim piety, 1850 to 1947, and completed his doctoral research as a Commonwealth Scholar, being affiliated to the Department of History, Royal Holloway, University of London. His area of specialization is Islam and Islamic mysticism in medieval and modern South Asia. He has 4 published books to his name. He is also the co-editor of the Bengali academic journal, Itikotha, and the resident editor of Indo-Iranica, The Comprehensive History of Indian Society, CHIS, has selected him as the joint editor for volume 10. Dr. De has published over 50 articles on Islam and Islamic mysticism in academic journals. He has delivered lectures in famous institutions all over the world, such as the University of Chicago, North Carolina State University, Louisiana State University, University of California, Santa Barbara, University of Heidelberg, University of Roma. It almost spans the whole world. Nearly 33 scholars have successfully completed their PhD or MPhil under his supervision, and at present, 8 scholars are carrying out their research under his guidance. So I yield the floor to this very brilliant man, Dr. Omit De.
Thank you, Dr. Devapriya Sanyal, for a very generous introduction. Thank you, Dr. Rathindranath Bosu, for inaugurating the webinar. Dr. Roy, my fellow speaker, Dr. Aparna Bandyopadhyay. I am particularly grateful to Srimati Manjuri Chakraborty, head of the Department of History, Surendranath Evening College, who contacted me and continuously stayed in touch with me so that a theme like this could gradually evolve. It's a very significant topic, as Dr. Sanyal has already pointed out. I'm grateful to the college. I'm grateful to the principal madam for giving me this opportunity to share my views. Now, my job is a little bit challenging because you can see that my journey is a long journey from the medieval period to the colonial period. Now, it is very significant that when the Quran, Holy Quran, discusses Joseph, there's an indication, there's a focus on the power, on the potential power of enrapturing love, focus on love. I'm saying this because we shall be dealing with mysticism as well, as indicated by Dr. Sanyal, that the mystics often try to legitimize their position regarding women's issues by citing the Quran, by citing the Hadith, that is the sayings and deeds of the Prophet, by citing the Sirat, that is the biography of the Prophet, and so on. So, the starting point, entry point is Quran. We shall see how Quranic instructions could be interpreted by Indian mystics, Indian saints, Indian theologians when they entered in the discourse involving women. That is very crucial. That's why I started with the Holy Quran. That in the Holy Quran, there is scope to discuss this issue regarding women within Islamic societies all over the world. Now, it can even be said that Sufism was more favorable to the development of feminine activities than were any branches of Islam. Because we have seen wherever Sufism became popular, women came to enjoy a greater amount of freedom. The sympathy of the Prophet for women and his four daughters is well known. The veneration of Fatima, that is the beloved, one of the beloved daughters of the Prophet, Fatima. Fatima is very significant. We shall have occasions to discuss Fatima. Fatima is the symbol of mystical knowledge. Now, there are different layers of knowledge. When we shall discuss this gender issue, this women's issue, you have to keep it in the back of your mind that knowledge is not homogeneous. There are different layers of knowledge. And Fatima, the beloved daughter of the Prophet and the wife of Ali, you know the film song, Kawali song, Damadam Mast Kalandar, Ali the Paira Number, that Ali is the husband of Fatima. And Fatima is venerated very much in the Shia world, in Iran, and also parts of Iraq where you have significant Shia population. So, if you discuss the feminine elements within Islam, you have to remember such things, such symbols within Quran, such Quranic surahs, and also such family members of the Prophet who are venerated within the Muslim communities and Muslim societies all over the world. But we shall be focusing our discussion in South Asia for the time constraint that has been inflicted on us for due reason. Now, the Quran speaks repeatedly of the al-Muslimin wa al-Muslimat. You know, Quran is written in Arabic. Al-Muslimin wa al-Muslimat wa al-Muminin wa al-Muminat. For Muslim men and women, and for believing men and women. So the appeal of Quran is very, very inclusive. There's an appeal to both men and women. So this is very significant. So when we have to select an entry point, so far as discussion and discourse on women is concerned, Quran can be the starting point. And Quran has been interpreted, Quran has been cited by the mystics as well as the theologians, and also the scholars when they discussed the position of women within Islam, both in medieval and South and as colonial context. That is very much important. So I started with the Quran. So the very fact that the first true saint of Islam was a woman. The first true saint of Islam was a woman. The first person apart from the Prophet Muhammad who embraced Islam is a woman. Bibi Khadija, the wife of the Prophet, was the first person within Islam, apart from the Prophet Muhammad, who is embraced Islam. This is a very significant information. So women are very much respected and venerated within Islamic understanding that you have to understand, remember. And the great lover was Rabia Basri. She was from Basra. That's why Basri, Rabia Basri. If you follow Muslim names, sometimes place names are attached with the main name, the first name. So Rabia Basri, she was from Basra. She flourished in the 8th century. The women played a leading role in the theological world, in the spiritual world, quite early in the history of Islam. That is our entry point. That is very important. Now, Rabia is so popular within Muslim societies all over the world that if you notice any pious woman within the Muslim societies, she is compared with Rabia, and often she is just projected as the second Rabia. This is true also in case of South Asia, that is India. Now, before Sufism arose, women were recognized as saints, such as Amina. You know that Nazrul song, Tura Dekhe Ja Amina Maer Kole. So Amina is the mother of the Prophet. So this is very significant. Amina, the mother of the Prophet, is venerated by Muslims. And Fatima is the beloved daughter, which I have already shared with you, who enjoy veneration of all Muslims because of their relationship to the Prophet. So it is not surprising that when Sheikh Abdul Haq Muhaddis Dehlavi, a contemporary of Jahangir, he was a great scholar Sufi, Alim Sufi. Alim, that is, he had scriptural knowledge. He was a Maulavi. At the same time, he was a Sufi. So Alim Sufi, not Sufi Alim. This term is used. So he was both an Alim as well as a Sufi. He was a great scholar who wrote in Persian, New Arabic, and other languages. He flourished during the time of Jahangir. Now, this is very significant. I draw your attention to this very important fact, that Sheikh Abdul Haq Muhaddis Dehlavi, carefully follow the name. Sheikh means leader. Sheikh can be a Sufi. Sheikh can be a scholar. Sheikh Abdul Haq, his actual name is Abdul Haq. Muhaddis is not his name. Muhaddis is his title. Since he was learned in Hadith, that's why he is Muhaddis. Aisha was a female. She was learned in Hadith, Muhaddisa. So feminine term is Muhaddisa. And masculine term is Muhaddis. So Abdul Haq Muhaddis Dehlavi. And he flourished in Delhi. That's why Dehlavi. So this, if you have to follow the names of Muslim scholars, you have to follow very carefully. You have to follow the entire name so that you can locate that particular scholar or saint in the particular milieu, socio-cultural milieu. So Abdul Haq Muhaddis Dehlavi, otherwise you can see that he was a scripturalist. He was well versed in scriptures. He was well versed in hadith. But I draw your attention to this fact that in spite of his apparent conservative identity, he devoted an entire chapter in his very famous work, Akbarul Akhiyar, to women. An entire chapter in the book was devoted to women. I draw your attention to this fact. In the Persian language, he wrote this book. So this is a very significant information for us. Now, you can juxtapose the scholars Sufi of the medieval period with the scholars of today. And sometimes, I leave it to you, but if you compare, sometimes you may find, I think, that medieval scholars, the medieval predecessors, they were more liberal even when they are projected as relatively conservative personalities. This is significant. Now, it's a debate going on. I will have to cut the story short because of the time constraint. This is called by German scholars as alternative modernity. That modernity is not the monopoly of the West. A form of modernity was also generated in the Oriental world because of the activities of the mystic scholars or scholar mystics. This is very much important. There is one example. He was so modern, so inclusive, that he devoted an entire chapter on female Sufis, on women. Very important. Without this chapter, we could not have written. I have written a chapter on female Sufis. I could not have written the chapter on female Sufis without this Persian book on that at least devoted one chapter, entire chapter on women saints. This is very significant. Sheikh Nizamuddin Aulia, the 13th century, who died in the early 14th century, 13th century famous Chisti saint of South Asia. There was a majlis, and in the majlis, his followers asked him, what should be the position of women in society? Now look, carefully follow the response of Nizamuddin Aulia, one of the most illustrious Chisti saints of South Asia, entire South Asia. Sher az besha biru ayed, kase purshid ki ashe norast ya mada. I'm translating from Persian. When a lioness emerges from the forest, no one raises any question about her sex. Because the primary concern of the human being at that moment is his personal safety and security. So he'll be fleeing for life. He will be running for life when you see a lioness emerging from the forest. He will not ask, he will not carry out a research to see whether that is a male or a female. Very significant. The Sufis had a sense of humor. So Sufis were very, in a very allegorical manner, they used to instruct their followers. So this was the response of Nizamuddin Aulia when he was asked this question, what should be the position of women in society? He implied that women are as powerful as lioness. You have watched Animal Planet. The lioness is the principal predator, not the lion. Lion's presence in the lion family is rather parasitical. So lioness is the principal predator. So in other words, he implied, rather in an allegorical fashion, why I can keep you pondering, I can keep you just thinking on this issue, why he is using such allegories to respond to such a crucial, pertinent question. And that a woman can be compared with a lioness, implied that a woman can possess spiritual qualities, and under such circumstances, she can be elevated in the spiritual hierarchy just like a male, her male counterpart. So this was the position, egalitarian position, just reflected by Nizamuddin Awliya in that majlis, very important. It would be relevant to study the role of the mothers, very important. Mothers in the biographies of the Sufis. Biographies of the Sufis are known as Tazkira. Tazkira is very important. You know, biography of the Bhakti saints is very important. So I see this issue in this way, that the mothers of many Bhakti saints are venerated within India. So the Sufis created a literature, parallel literature, where the mothers of Sufi saints were also venerated in that sort of biographies, Tazkira, as I've already mentioned. So mothers of saints are very much venerated within the Indian tradition, as it is resonated in the pages of Tazkira or the biographies of the Sufis. First religious instruction which the Sufis received, almost inevitably they received it from their mothers. That's why the Prophet even said that the paradise lies at the feet of the mothers. The paradise lies at the feet of the mothers. Very important. So earlier I have referred I have cited the Quran. Now I am citing the Hadith. That is, paradise lies at the feet of the mothers, uttered by the Prophet Muhammad himself. Sayings and deeds of the Prophet is Hadith. So the Sufis played a significant role. This is often not acknowledged. Played a significant role in popularizing the Quran and Hadith in Indian society. They popularized the Hadith. They made the Hadith relevant to the common people, intelligible to the common people, relevant to the Indian circumstances. So the Prophet venerated his mother in one way or other. That is manifested in the Hadith that I have shared with you. Now, whether it will be Baba Farid Ganji Shakkar of Punjab, Baba Farid Ganji Shakkar is the master or murshid of Nizamuddin Awliya. I've mentioned Nizamuddin Awliya. He also venerated his mother. There is no doubt that many elderly women within the Sufi families contributed to the spiritual formation of some of the greatest Sufis of South Asia, greatest Sufi saints of South Asia. So women had been venerated as mothers of prominent Sufi saints in South Asian history and culture. This is one important observation I will demonstrate from one Sufi text available in the Persian language. I have translated it. On one occasion, there was a drought, that is Imsak-e-Bara. There was a drought in Delhi. Everybody began to pray for rain. Bara means rain. And the sheikh, one particular Sufi sheikh or saint, was requested to do likewise. Because the people believed that if the Sufi joined in that prayer, there will be rain. There will be good harvest following that rainfall, adequate rainfall. The sheikh then took a thread from a garment worn by his mother. He held it in his hand and began to pray. I'm just quoting, "O God, the chastity of my mother is well known. She had never unveiled her face before the strangers, and I am praying on behalf of this pious lady. Please send rain for us. Ask Sheikh in Haraf Guftan, ask Khuda Bara Ferestadan." That is the Persian thing. After hearing the sheikh's appeal, God sent rain for them. So this is the supernatural power of a Sufi mother that is being shared, that is being popularized in the biographies, in the Tazkira. So this supernatural power was attaching this supernatural power with the motherhood of a Sufi saint. You are actually legitimizing the image of a Sufi mother within the Indian subcontinent. And this had similarity with the ways the Bhakti saints popularize their mothers in the Bhakti biographies, in the Bhakti texts. This is very significant. Now, you may ask me this question, that these are Persian texts. whether the Sufis try to reach out to the masses in the vernacular language, because the vernacular language will be intelligible to the masses. Common people will not follow Persian. So what is the mechanism followed by the Sufis to reach out to the masses, to engage with the masses in a more creative manner? So this is very interesting. I will just share with you certain types of Sufi literature, mainly composed in the vernacular language, maybe Dakni Urdu in the Deccan, maybe Bengali in Bengal, maybe Sindhi in Sindh, maybe Punjabi in Punjab, maybe Urdu in northern India. Charkha Nama. Charkha, you know, Charkha was very popular to Gandhi. Gandhi popularized Charkha. I'm not going into that. In the interactive session, I will be delighted to respond some queries involving Gandhi with Sufism. Charkha was popularized by Gandhi, but Charkha Nama from time immemorial was popular in India. Now the Sufis utilize this popularity of Charkha and compose songs in the vernacular languages, as I've mentioned already. And these sort of songs are known as Charkha Nama. That is, the women folk, when they use the Charkha, they used to sing the song to generate a sort of a physical energy. That is very much important. Charkha Nama, they were popularly known as Charkha Nama. For example, the central point of the Charkha, wheel of the Charkha, looks like Mim. Mim for Muhammad. Mim is the Arabic letter. And the handle of the Charkha, if seen from 90 degree angle, looks like the letter Alif. Alif for Allah. So when you are operating the Charkha like this, the women folk will be chanting Allah Muhammad, Allah Muhammad. This is singable. This is singable. So in this way, Sufis try to reach out to the women folk, even in the countryside, through this sort of Charkha Namas being composed by the very very creative, imaginaire Sufi saints in South Asia. And there had been Chakki Nama also. Chakki, or the metallic rod, is often used to grind food grains. And this Chakki, when looked from 90 degree angle, looks like Alif, Alif for Allah. The Chakki Nama, while grinding food grains, songs were sung by the female folk in the countryside. So in this way, the Sufis were, in a very creative manner, imaginative manner, were engaging with the women folk in the countryside. Women were not peripheral within Sufism. They entered the mainstream of Sufi spiritual practices in this way. Lori Nama, that is the lullabies. When you are sending your child to sleep, when they are asleep, you are singing these sort of songs to facilitate drowsiness of the child. Lori Nama, these are important songs, mainly sung by ladies. So this is the feminine aspect of the folk songs composed by the Sufi saints. And also Suhagan Nama, that is the wedding songs, they mainly are sung in female voices. So these are the feminine dimensions utilized and also incorporated within Sufi experiences of life. That is very much crucial. I am sharing that with you. Nizamuddin Awliya had deep respect for his mother. He used to say, Walida Mara Bakhuda Tala Asnai Bhut. My mother was the way towards the kingdom of God. Very important. Now, Nizamuddin Awliya came from Central Asia, from Balkh to Badayun. He first came to Badayun. His father died early. He came with his mother when he was a child. Bibi Zulekha was his mother. I draw your attention to this fact. This mother played a very prominent role in the selection of teachers, appropriate teachers for the training of his son. So look at the executive power of the mother. Mother is translating into practice the desire to train his son by selecting able teachers for his son. So this is the dominant position of women in some of the Turkish tribes. He was a Turk, I have mentioned. So Bibi Zulekha is coming to India, to Badayun from Balkh. And after coming to India, Bibi Zulekha found that Sultana Razia was ruling India, was ruling from Delhi. This is a significant information for us. Sultana Razia is also a Turk. And I have mentioned that some of the Turkish tribes were matriarchal families. They had matriarchal understanding of life. So this is very much important. So we have discussed that this favorable disposition of the Sufis towards the women folk This can be linked not only to Sufi theology, not only to Quran, not only to Tazkira, not only to Chisti Sufi practice, but also to this sort of matriarchal habits of some of the Turkish tribes in Central Asia. So they carried forward some of the matriarchal habits when they migrated to India. This is very much significant. So this explains why some of the Sufis were favorably disposed towards the women folk in India. The devotees of Raushan Bibi, I am now coming to Bengal, medieval Bengal. Devotees of Raushan Bibi have built a beautiful Durga. He's a 13th century female Sufi of Bengal in the Bosirhat subdivision in the Taragunia village near the banks of Ichamuti River. So Bibi's followers, I mean Raushan Bibi's followers, have built a beautiful Durga. As a mark of their devotion, the Zimmadars, that is the Sebayat, the trustees of the Durga, have kept the place very neat and clean. Incense is also burnt regularly at the Durga. The devotees offer flowers, fruits and sweets at the Durga as minnat. Actually, we use the term manot. Manot is not a Bengali word. It is derived from the Arabic term minnat. This is interesting. Minnat. Every year in the Bengali month of Choitro, Urs, that is the death anniversary of a Sufi saint, is celebrated here with much enthusiasm. So death is very significant within Sufism, within Islam. And this understanding of death has a gender dimension. I may not delve deep into all aspects today because of the time constraint, but we shall elaborate later on if you interact with me over the emails. On this occasion of Urs, a fair is also held here, which lasts for nearly 10 days. More than 1 lakh people visit this fair, and they are entertained by the bandsmen, kawal singers. You know, kawali, I have mentioned kawali a while ago. This music is very important. This music is associated with the female presence within the Sufi festivals. And also, music poses a serious challenge to hegemonic orthodoxy. That's why Rabindranath Tagore and Gandhi, they were in favor of music and dance, because music and dance pose a challenge to hegemonic orthodoxy, and Sufism also represents heterodoxy, and sometimes they represent a challenge to hegemonic orthodoxy. So this interconnectedness is very important. And the night sky is beautifully decorated with fireworks. And it is said that Raja Krishnachandra Roy donated land for the erection of the Durga a long time ago. Because Krishnachandra also was keen to enhance his popularity among the masses, because he knew both the Hindus and Muslims used to visit the Durga. So an interfaith dialogue is sustained by such Sufi festivities. This is important. I draw your attention to this fact. So while I am discussing this gendered discourse was entangled with this interfaith dialogue in the subcontinent, entangled with composite culture in the Indian subcontinent. That is also a crucial aspect to remember. It is a well-known fact that Mian Mir was the first mystical guide of the Mughal prince, an ill-fated Mughal prince, Darashiko. Darashiko, you know, Shahjahan's eldest son, who was supposed to be the monarch but could not become the monarch at all. He was executed by his younger brother, Aurangzeb. So Mian Mir's name is very significant. Mian Mir was destined to be the Murshid or guide of Darashuko. So you have to understand that in the European Renaissance, there was a linkage between court Renaissance and popular Renaissance. So in India, if you have to understand the gender discourse, if you have to understand the contribution of mysticism towards the efflorescence of Indian composite culture, you have to understand the linkages between court culture and popular culture. So far, we have cited some aspects of popular culture, through Chakki Nama to Charkha Nama to Lori Nama and Suhagan Nama. Now let us once again come back to the court culture, the elite culture, the Ashraf culture, represented by the Mughals, represented by Jahanara, represented by Darashuko and others. This Mian Mir was venerated by Darashuko, and Mian Mir's name is important. I was speaking about composite culture. Mian Mir was supposed to be the guru of Darashuko and Jahanara, but he died early. That's why his disciple Mullah Shah actually became the guru of Darashuko. So Mian Mir was asked to lay the foundation stone of the Gurdwara, main Gurdwara of the Sikhs. So this is very important. The sheikhs used to venerate me and me. This is an example of composite culture. That the sheikhs had to become belligerent towards the Mughals for various other reasons. Otherwise, spiritually speaking, culturally speaking, they shared the cosmopolitan culture unleashed by the Mughals. Otherwise, they would not have invited the mystic saint, Sufi saint, me and me to lay the foundation stone of Harmandir Sahib. The original Gurdwara of the Sheikhs, Harmandir Sahib, that is very important that you have to understand. Venerated by the Sheikhs, Harmandir Sahib, Gurdwara. Mian Mir's daughter was also had also mystical knowledge. Was Bibi Jamal Khatun, was very popular, was an outstanding Qadriya Sufi saint. So the Chistis and the Qadris played a prominent role so far as this gender discourse is concerned. So far as sustaining this gender discourse in Indian mysticism is concerned, the Chistis and Qadriyas played a prominent role. And this linkage with the Sheikhs, which I have already mentioned, is very significant. The Sheikhs shared something in common with the Sufis. Say the langar. Even today, you will notice the langar is mainly managed by females, by women. So langar was a practice followed by the Sufis as well, the free kitchen. So through langar, the Sufis and the Sheikhs tried to translate into practice their egalitarian principles. So I'm not delving deep into that, but these are important aspects. Their inclusivity is resonated in the act of langar when women were playing a major role in conducting the langar, both in Sikhism and in Sufism. That is very important that you have to understand. A message of humanity is spread through that. I cannot delve deep into all aspects. So Jahanara was very learned in mystical knowledge. Her informal name is Fatima. Fatima is the beloved daughter of the Prophet. Fatima is known for mystical knowledge. Jahanara is also known for mystical knowledge. So Jahanara actually was so learned that in the Persian language, she composed the biography of Khwaja Moinuddin Chisti, the doyen of the Chisti saints in South Asia. And that text in the Persian language composed by Jahanara is known as Munis-ul-Arwa. So look at the learning process of women, elite women, and that was sustained by Sufi activities. Sufis played a major role so far as the sustenance of gender dimension in South Asian history and culture is concerned. Now, this Munis-ul-Arwa, that is dedicated to Moinuddin Chisti of Ajmer, actually means the comforter of souls. That is, she projected Moinuddin Chisti of Ajmer as the comforter of human souls. Very important. But the magnetic personality and piety of Mian Mir and the reputation of Mullah Shah drew Darashuko towards the Qadriya fraternity. So Mughals were gradually moving from Chisti order to the Qadriya order. Qadriyas are very significant. I may not have the time to delve deep into that because I am discussing gender, not Sufism. But it is very interesting that how Qadris were interested in Vedas and Upanishads also. Not only interested in involving women in the spiritual activities, but were also interested in Vedas and Upanishads. And you know, Darashuko, another Qadriya Sufi, also just translated the Upanishad into Persian, known as Sirri Akbar. So these entanglements are very important. Darashuko, Jahanara, Jahanara Chisti, Jahanara Qadri, this sort of connectivity is very important so far as sustenance of gender dimension in South Asia is concerned. Now, there's a time constraint. I will very quickly switch over to the colonial period, Muslim women in the context of the colonial period. And I think 1870s is a demarcating decade, is a defining decade in the history of gender discourse in South Asia. Because in the 1870s, we notice the emergence of educated Muslim middle class. In the 1870s, we notice the optimum utilization of printing technology within the Bengali Muslim community. We find that the W.W. Hunter is changing his attitude towards the Indian Muslims in 1870s. His book, The Indian Musulmans, had been published in the 1870s. We have seen that the Wahhabi trials had been executed in the 1870s. We have seen that pan-Islamic ideas started to spread through this sort of texts from 1870s. These are very important. We see the emergence of first Bengali Muslim novelist in the form of Musharraf Hussain also in the 1870s. These are important findings. And Musharraf Hussain not only wrote many novels, not only wrote another very important book. I draw your attention to the fact, Amar Jiboner Jiboni. Amar Jiboner Jiboni. It's an autobiographical work where he glorified his second wife, Bibi Kulsum. Now, Kulsum is one of the daughters of the Prophet. And Musharraf Hussain's wife, Mir Musharraf Hussain, was a novelist. His wife's name was also Bibi Kulsum. So Musharraf Hussain tried to educate her wife, and her wife was educated. So when you speak about women's education, you have to discuss this autobiographical work by Musharraf Hussain, Amar Jiboner Jiboni, very important. And you will find this gender discourse also in the novel by Gaur Kishore Ghosh, Prem Nei, and also the novel Abdullah, very important. Now, in the 19th century, Keramat Ali Jaunpuri, who was an alim, a mullah, but he was not a Bengali speaking alim. He mainly stayed in Bengal, but he was an ambulatory alim who came from Jaunpur. You can gather from his name. He could understand Bengali, but he was Urdu speaking. So he noticed that due to the activities of the Bengali Hindu intelligentsia, mainly Brahmo intelligentsia, there was a very lively debate going on in Bengal about women. That and he was one of the pioneers so far as writing a text in the Urdu language on women's education is concerned. This is very significant. As early as in 1827 and 28, he composed in Urdu, Miftahul Jannat. Miftahul Jannat, and he was very much impressed by the discourse on women going on in Bengal, mainly that was being spearheaded by the Brahmo leaders. And he composed this book, Miftahul Jannat, where he expressed the view that women should be educated within Islam. That is very important. Now, I draw your attention to this fact that you have to, let us put it in an equation. Subtle tension was going on within the Bengal Muslim society from the late 19th century, as I have already indicated. M4, remember this. One M is for Maulavi. Maulavi is trying to exercise his power, exercise his control in the Muslim society, Bengali Muslim society. Middle class was emerging, as I have already indicated. Mir Musharraf Hussain was a middle class representative. Middle class was emerging. Another M. Image of the Prophet, image of Muhammad was becoming popular. Muhammad was being portrayed as the leader of the Muslim community in Bengal. So Muhammad's image is very important. You will find that in Gaur Kishore Ghosh's Prem Nei, Shafiqul Islam, the main character is venerating the Prophet, the Muhammad. So M, another M is Muhammad. Another image is what should be the attitude towards Murshid, the Sufi Peer. Another aim. So there was a subtle tension going on between these four aims. Who will be venerated? Whose position will be what within Bengali Muslim society? Maulavi, middle class, Muhammad, and Murshid. Very important. If you discuss the gender, this gender dimension will remain incomplete if you fail to understand this equation between these four aims: Maulavi, middle class, Muhammad, and Murshid. Now, you have to understand that this was not an isolated development. In Aligarh also, biographies of the Prophet was being written. The biography of the Prophet was being written in Aligarh. So Aligarh movement was also trying to portray the image of the Prophet. But remember, this is the rational image of the Prophet. Rational image of the Prophet. I have spoken about the fact that knowledge is not monolithic. Yeah, knowledge is different. Knowledge has different layers. The wife of the Prophet represented scriptural knowledge. That's why Aisha is known as Muhaddisa. Aisha was popular in urban Bengal. Aisha was not that popular in rural Bengal. I may or may not have the time to elaborate on that later on. Fatima, the beloved daughter of the Prophet, was the representative of mystical knowledge, I have already mentioned. Khadija, the first wife of the Prophet, represented commercial knowledge, represented household knowledge, home science, and also represented social knowledge. Very important, Khadija, commercial knowledge. Actually, the Prophet was employed by Khadija as a camel driver, Mir Karwa, caravan leader. Khadija was quite rich. Khadija was a widow, was married to the Prophet, was elder to the Prophet. So they were very happy. I will have occasions to come back to this conjugal relationship between the Prophet Muhammad and Khadija. What was its significance in Bengali Muslim society in the late 19th and early 20th centuries? This is very crucial. One important debate is Parda. Parda means veil. Or which sort of Parda should be followed? Now, most of the Muslim intelligentsia, like Amir Ali, like Rokeya Sakwat Hussain, they settle down on moderate Parda. That is, Parda should be observed, but a moderate form of Parda can be observed in Bengali Muslim society. So there was a debate that was going on, which sort of Parda should be followed, rigid Parda or modest Parda or moral Parda. So settlement was in favor of moral Parda. For modesty, some sort of Parda should be maintained, but that will be a moderate Parda, not very rigid Parda. Now, again, if we switch over to the countryside, you will find that often Muslim women are observing Parda. They are working in the field side by side with the male folk without observing the veil. There are different reasons, because if you observe the Parda in that context, that will be dangerous, because there are snakes and other things. You have to be very much aware in the field, in the rice field, to carry out your activities. There, in the evening, after a monotonous life, day life, hard life in the rice field, evening was meant for some sort of recreation. Jari songs and other forms of folk songs are sung, where women used to take part, but observing the veil. That is, women were asked to listen to the jari songs from behind the bamboo curtain. So this Parda is different from urban Parda. You can understand. The women are not visible, so it is not necessary to observe the strict Parda. They can listen to the folk songs from beyond the bamboo fence. So I call it provincialization of Parda. There is always a tension going on between the universal symbols of Islam or religion and the provincial or local symbol of religion. So here I will say this bamboo. Bamboo is not available easily in the desert region. It is available in Bengal. It is available in Assam. So this sort of bamboo fence is actually a provincial version of the Parda, provincial version of the veil. That's why I call this sort of a ritual as the provincialization of Parda. This is integral to the identity formation of the common people in the countryside. That you have to understand very well. Now, another important debate that took place, that some people discussed, that when Aisha led the battle of the camel, led in the battle of the camel, some people said that those who were anti-Parda, they said Aisha was not probably using the Parda, strict Parda, when she was leading the battle, leading the battalion in the battle of the camel, famous battle of the camel. But some others said, no, look, Aisha was maintaining the veil and was leading the battalion in the battle of the camel. So these sort of debates are there. I am not delving deep into the literature that is available before us because of the time constraint. Another important dimension that featured in this gender discourse is healthcare and hygiene aspect. Now remember, these are very much entangled with contemporary developments. You might remember that there was a Balkan war going on. Turkey was in danger because of some Balkan countries which attacked Turkey. So Turkey was at war with many Balkan countries in 1912, that is before the, on the eve of the First World War. That is very much important. And there was a Red Crescent medical mission from India to Turkey. And when there was one from Siraji, Ismail Hussain Siraji went from Bengal in that medical mission, came back to Bengal and said that women came to enjoy greater freedom in Turkey, in the Balkan wars, as non-combatants. So these are important. And these women are very conscious about health and hygiene. This is very much important that you have to understand. And there was another project against the this sort of medical consciousness, hygiene consciousness. Akram Khan was editing a newspaper, editing a journal, Mashik Mohammadi. There he discussed elaborately on this sort of consciousness regarding health and hygiene relating to women. So this is very much important. that you have to understand. And Akram Khan also pointed out that women were allowed to even challenge the Khulafa-e Rashidin, and the women were allowed to debate with the Khulafa-e Rashidin. And he cited from one Sahih Hadith, that is authentic Hadith, that women came to enjoy great power in the prophetic era, in the classical era of Islam. And they were even allowed to debate with Hazrat Umar regarding certain feminine issues. I am not going into that. Abul Kalam Azad's pan-Islam is another aspect that I am not going to discuss here because there is a time constraint. I just try to mention that there were even non-Muslim authors who were writing the biographies of the Prophet in the late 19th and early 20th century, and they also in this biographies of the Prophet, family members of the Prophet had been used as role models by the biographers, and some of the biographers are non-Muslims. They were Brahmos and Hindus who composed these biographies of the Prophet to promote a better understanding between different communities, to promote comparative theological studies in Bengal. So they were carrying out this work, and they mentioned the role of women in Muslim society, and they hailed the step taken by the Prophet and his family members so far as women, a redefinition of women's role in society is concerned. That is very much crucial. Now, you know that there was an All India Muslim Ladies Conference, popularly known as Anjuman, All India Muslim Ladies Conference, or popularly known as Anjuman, where the Begum of Bhopal patronized the publication of books on child rearing, on healthcare, and so on. So, Begum of Bhopal, it's not only a Bengali phenomenon. This was happening in Upper India, this was happening in MP and other places as well. It is portrayed in many, in the Deobandi circles and also in the Sirat literature. Sirat means biography of the Prophet. That Prophet was very neat and clean. So, there was an emphasis on cleanliness by citing the example of the Prophet, and women were asked to use the Prophet as a role model when it comes to the question of health and hygiene in society. Not only Bengali Muslim society, but in Urdu-speaking society, Sindhi society, Punjabi society as well. The Prophet took great care to clean his teeth, miswak, great care to clean his teeth. So this health consciousness was popularized by citing the example of the Prophet among the women population. And Fazlul Karim is writing a book in Bengali, Bibi Khadija. Bibi Khadija is a biographical work on Bibi Khadija, the first wife of the Prophet, who is projected as a role model here in this Bengali biography of Khadija. And Khadija is projected as Tahira. Tahira is someone who is very clean. So cleanliness is very important. Now the British were putting emphasis on cleanliness. You know, there had been many epidemics in the late 19th century, cholera and other things, other sorts of epidemics. There was the tap water, which was introduced in late 19th century. So these were also reflected in the biographical literature, in the gender discourses. So women members of the Prophet's family were projected as people who promoted and sustained cleanliness in society. This is very much important. Another very interesting, important example is there in this biography. Aisha's grandmother, that is, Aisha is the wife of the Prophet. Grandmother told her that early rising is good for the health, moderate meals is good for the health, regular meals should be taken at regular intervals. These are important dimensions. Now, in 1900, there was a famine, as you know. And the Hindu social workers required a Florence Nightingale to inspire the Hindu women to carry forward relief activities during this famine. Florence Nightingale, you know who is Florence Nightingale, I need not elaborate. During the Balkan Wars, when Ismail Hossain Shirazi came back and started to write in the articles in the Bengali Muslim journals on his experience about the women playing the role of non-combatants in the battlefield in Turkey and in the Balkan region, there, Aisha and Fatima had been projected as Florence Nightingales of Bengali Muslim society. This is very significant. So Prophet advised his followers to nurse the sick people. There had been very many prophetic wars, as you know. So Prophet asked followers to take care of the sick people who were wounded in the warfare, should be taken care of. And so women can play a role as non-combatants by taking care of these wounded soldiers. That is very crucial. And again, in the 20th century context, on the eve of First World War, women were playing this role of non-combatants and were playing the emulating Florence Nightingales to extend their service to the wounded soldiers of their fighting community. This is very important. Another important discourse came to the fore was marriage. marriage question was very issue in this gender aspect. Widow remarriage issue was very important. Child marriage issue was discussed. Polygamy was discussed. Talak or divorce issue was discussed. These four major dimensions had been discussed in contemporary literature so far as discourse on women is concerned. Widow remarriage, child marriage, polygamy, and divorce. Now, there had been a lack of widow remarriage within Muslim society. So the social reformers argued that probably due to the influence, Hindu influence, there was a reluctance among the Muslim to marry a widow. So this is one aspect. So Vidyasagar, when he launched his widow remarriage campaign, as you know, he cited the example of Muslim communities and said that in Islamic scriptures, there is no injunction against widow remarriage. And rather, widow remarriage is hailed in Islamic civilization. So Vidyasagar wanted to popularize his project of widow remarriage by citing the example of Muslim Islamic scriptures. This is very much important. And some of the Muslim reformers even went to the extent of saying that those who are discouraging widow remarriage, they are actually performing shirk and bidah, that is innovation and polytheism, that is un-Islamic. They are performing un-Islamic practices by discouraging widow remarriage. I am winding up. I know my time is ticking up. That is very much important. But there was one very prominent social reformer in late 19th century Bengal, Munshi Mohammad Meherullah of Jasor. He wrote a book, Vidhoba Ganjona O Bishad Bhandar. I think he was influenced at some point of time by Altaf Hussain Ali of Aligarh, who wrote the biography of Syed Ahmed Khan in Urdu. Altaf Hussain Ali was a famous Urdu poet and wrote Munajat-e-Bewa, that is the prayer of a widow. And he was also famous for composing Musaddas-e-Hali, you know. So Hali was an influence, was an impact on the Bengali Muslim writers when the writers such as Munshi Meherullah composed Vidhoba Ganjona or Bishad Bhandar, where he exposed the lamentation of the miserable widow in Bengali Muslim society and wanted to get rid of this constraint that was emulated from the Hindu society in the neighborhood. Zamiruddin, the disciple of Meherullah, said that Munshi Meherullah's book became very influential so far as emancipation of women is concerned in Bengal. That is very much important. So I draw your attention to this fact that Rukia Sakwat Hussain also said that the Prophet Muhammad used to console the widows. Yeah, Prophet Muhammad was a comforter of widows. That is, the Prophet Muhammad always was very sympathetic towards the widows. So there is a convergence of Deobandi school, Deobandi activities, and the Bengali Muslim intelligentsia. There is a convergence that they are sharing the same idea that widows should be taken care of, and widows should be venerated, widows should be allowed to remarry. This is one important aspect. And actually, being influenced by the Deobandi school, Bengali Muslim writers were also writing that majority of the Prophet's wives had been widows. Aisha was not a widow, but other wives were widows, including Khadija. So in this way, widow remarriage was being popularized by the Muslim intelligentsia during that period. That is very much important. Dukho Bharatur Bongo Bidhoba Hishabe Khadija ke kalpana kora hoyeche in Fazlul Karim's book. I have mentioned Hazrat Khadija in that book. Khadija was projected as Dukho Bharatur Bongo Bidhoba. So this aspect, so contemporary society played a significant role in reviving the image of Khadija, who himself was a widow but was an empowered widow within Islam during the prophetic era. I have mentioned earlier that she was the first person apart from the Prophet who embraced Islam, the new religion. Fazlul Karim says that the majority of the wives were widows, wives of the Prophets had been widows. Ashraf Ali Thanawi says that the who is a Deobandi scholar, Ashraf Ali Thanawi, who wrote Behesht-e-Zewar in Urdu in 1900 or something like that. Behesht-e-Zewar, that is heavenly ornaments. It's a gender-related book, as you can understand. There he elaborated his views that the groom's grooms are very greedy. Grooms greed for property, discouraged widow remarriage, because grooms will not get much property if they married a widow. So they were not, they were reluctant to marry a widow. This was the version of Ashraf Ali Thanavi of Deoband. Fazlul Karim said that there is an advantage, very interesting argument. There's an advantage of marrying a widow, because a widow who was married earlier was very experienced, had domestic skill. So if a Muslim man married a widow, there is some advantage as well. He might not get property, but he will be married to a very experienced lady who can, from the very beginning, take care of household activities, unlike another lady who was not married before. So this is one version by Fazlul Karim. Akram Khan very importantly pointed out, by citing a Sahih Hadith, that is authentic Hadith, that it was customary in the prophetic era, that is, it's a Sunnah, that taking the permission of an adult lady is important in Muslim society before arranging for her marriage. This was mentioned by Akram Khan. Now, Akram Khan was challenged regarding various aspects. I probably do not have the time to do that. I have to wind up, but during the discussion, I can discuss on that. Akram Khan has been challenged by other Bengali Muslim intelligentsia for various other reasons. Now, Sir Soyed Ahmed Khan, Amir Ali, and others, those who were actually in favor of monogamy, they pointed out, they actually focused more on the very successful conjugal life involving the Prophet Muhammad and Khadija. They directly did not say that they preferred monogamy, but they said under normal circumstances, monogamy is preferable, because during the 25 years of very successful, meaningful conjugal life involving the Prophet and Khadija, the Prophet did not marry for the second time during that first 25 years of his married life. And that was a very successful life with empowered Khadija present in the family of the Prophet. So actually, it is very difficult to maintain equality when you have many wives. So under normal circumstances, the spirit of the Quran says that monogamy is preferable, because in reality, it is very difficult to maintain equity when a behavioral concern is there involving all the wives. So it is better to have one wife under such circumstances. This spirit was recognized in various Islamic states, like in Northern Africa and Middle East. This is very much important. This debate became very important in the early 20th century. They cited the example of... So indirectly, by citing the example of Khadija, in the urban debate, people who were in favor of monogamy, they cited the example of Khadija. So the image of Khadija became important for this reason. And regarding a divorce was discouraged by the likes of Maulavi Akram Khan, Maulana Akram Khan, who was an alim. That divorce or talaq, a misuse of divorce, is equivalent to bidat. Bidat means innovation. That is against the sunnah. Against the sunnah. So misuse of talaq is bidat, or against the sunnah. That is not in conformity with the way of the Prophet or Tariqah-e Muhammadiyah. That is not in conformity with the prophetic way. Talaq was discouraged. Under it should be the ultimate resource. It should not be misused. It should not be frequently used. And they cited the example from Prophet's life, that Prophet just reared one slave. A manumitted slave in Prophet's family was Zaid. So by citing the case of Zaid and his wife Zainab, it was cited that this example was cited that the Prophet was opposed to the misuse of talaq. This is very important. And in novel Abdullah by Qazi Imdadul Haq, novel is very important. It was appearing in the 1920s. This novel Abdullah, simple marriage is prescribed. This is very significant. And the case of Fatima and Ali had been cited, that look, Fatima and Ali were involved in a simple marriage, because if you do not engage yourself in a simple marriage, you will be sliding into the eternal death trap of a Mahajan, and the Mahajan happened to be a Hindu Mahajan. So this is the case. If in case of simple marriage, you don't have to be indebted to the Mahajan, you can live a very happy and meaningful life. So simple marriage was prescribed in the novel Abdullah by Qazi Imdadul Haq. Khadija was the ideal life partner, was a just trader. Just trader was Muhammad. I was the caravan leader, ideal caravan leader, Mir-e Karwa. It was a time, as we have mentioned, when printing technology was emerging, Puthi literature was being replaced by printed literature, Sirat literature, which was often written in chaste Bengali, Sadhu Bangla. It confirmed the emergence of Bengali Muslim educated middle class, and Peer Abu Bakr of Furfura also played a significant role here. So I wind up by saying that Khadija and Aisha were popular in urban Bengal. But Fatima, who is the symbol of mystical knowledge, was popular in rural Bengal. And I wind up by citing just one example, since I've mentioned Fatima. Fatima is compared as an empowered woman in the Bengal countryside. Damadam Mas Kalandar Ali da Pahila number. Ali is the husband of Fatima. Fatima is very important, empowered Fatima, Ma Barkat, popular as Ma Barkat in the Bengal countryside. Ma Barkat. Fatima never visited India, but she is popular as Ma Barkat, the auspicious mother. I am just winding up by quoting one folk song, that is a rain song. I have mentioned about rain song in Persian a while ago, while referring to Persian texts. Now I wind up by citing one rain song in the Bengali language, in the colloquial language, where Fatima, who is popular in the countryside, is venerated, unlike Aisha and Khadija, who were popular in the rural pockets. So in the Bengal countryside, this rain song is like that. This is an example of empowered Fatima. Aye re megh rani, thang dhui dhui phela pani, bibi Fatima khoje pani, Allah tui dere pani. So this, in this way, Fatima became empowered in the Bengal countryside. So there are different aspects of gender empowerment in folk literature, but I have another speaker, very erudite, Dr. Aparna Bandyopadhyay. I have to stop here. I have taken, I have exceeded my time limit. So I'm sorry for that, but thank you for your patience. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Yes, of course, maybe we have overshot a bit, but your presentation was so lively. It was so brilliant. And we can talk about it the entire day. And there have been, as expected, a large number of questions. So, sir, it's a small request to you that if you can keep the answers very brief, then we might be able to cover all the questions. The first question is posed by Tonmoy Day, Assistant Professor, Department of History, Krishnanagar Government College. His question is, can Razia be named as Sultana Razia, as we know that she never married a Sultan?
Razia?
Can Razia be named as Sultana Razia, as we know that she never married a Sultan?
Okay. Very good question. Any other questions? Shall I take questions together?
Sir, there's a wide range of questions. So I think you should just give a brief answer and then I'll move on to the next question.
Sure. That would be nice. I won't say that. It's a very good question. Thank you for the question. Actually, Rabia was an empowered mystical lady. Look at the difference. Rabia was so engrossed in her spiritual quest that she thought that if she got the offer of marriage, one very illustrious saint offered to marry her, but she refused, Rabia, because she was so engrossed in the spiritual quest that she thought that family activities will be jeopardizing her spiritual quest. So that is one consideration that is different from the consideration of Sultana Razia. Razia wanted to remain unmarried, actually, for another reason. She did not want the empire to be subdivided among different people. So she remained unmarried and she wanted to monopolize power. If she got married, then she would be dominated by her husband and there could be a claim to raise her husband as the monarch. So under political circumstances, Razia remained unmarried. Under spiritual circumstances, Rabia remained unmarried. These are different cases, but both are empowered ladies. Both are empowered ladies. That is very important. Thank you for the query.
Thank you, sir. The next question is posed by Momita Dasgupta, who is a faculty member of our college. Her question is, the Sufi influence in Indian society has been syncretic in nature. Now, in this context, what was the role played by Fatima Bibi?
Fatima Bibi now, which Fatima Bibi? There are many Fatimas. Could you make it clear? Okay. Remember, Fatima flourished during the prophetic time. She did not come to India. She is venerated as Ma Barkat or the auspicious mother. I mean, the Fatima is the beloved daughter of the Prophet. But this is a very popular name. There are several female saints, more than one female saints, who were known as Bibi Fatima or Fatima Sam, popular in northern India. And I have mentioned that Jahanara was also, Jahanara also had a nickname, Fatima. So, which Fatima you are speaking about? The Fatima, Sufi saint of northern India, they played a very significant role. But remember, regarding their constraints, because these they were very venerated as female, very much venerated as female saints. But their constraint was that they were disadvantaged because they were women, that I have to acknowledge. They could not leave behind any silsila or Sufi order like their male counterparts. They could not leave behind any Sufi text like Malfuzat or Maktubat or Tazkira like their male counterparts. That is, they did not leave behind their instructions very systematically produced in the manuscript form. This was reserved for the male Sufis. But still, these female Sufis were fighting for justice, fighting for recognition. So this was their solo effort. They are spiritual loners. But as spiritual loners, they are fighting for equality, they are fighting for justice, they are fighting for empowerment, emancipation, and egalitarian principle should be ushered in by the society. They were expecting that. But they still remained isolated. But remember, they did not belong to any particular Sufi order. They were spiritual loners. Unlike the male Sufis, they did not leave behind any particular Sufi order. Mohinuddin Chisti established the Chisti order. No? So the female Sufis did not create any order. They did not leave behind any major book, Tazkira, Malfuzat or Maktubat. No. But male Sufis left behind any systematic instructions for their followers. So these were the limitations, but still they were fighting for justice. But this was the entry point. They set the ball rolling. Herein lies their importance. When Fatima was imagined in the Bengal countryside as the empowered Fatima, she was acting as the, in the popular imagination, was acting as a counterpart of Saraswati and Kali. Saraswati and Kali had been the empowered female deities. But deification is not allowed in Islam. It's a monotheistic religion. So Fatima was the counterpart in a way that in a mystical way she was imagined as an empowered lady, as I mentioned when I recited that folk song. So in this way, Fatima became important, not in the real sense always. Thank you for your question, Maumita.
Thank you, sir. The next question, two questions can be taken together, sir, to shorten things easier. One question is asked by Pratiti Bhattacharya, other is by Aditi Bose. Now, question of Pratiti Bhattacharya is, can you talk about the greater independence, but the reasons for the greater independence accorded to women among the Turkish tribes? And Aditi Bose's question is, what was the position of women in sacred spaces like Darga, which were most often considered as male-dominated spheres? So I thought two oppositional points of view. So if you can talk about it together.
Yeah, thank you. It's a very important questions, Pratiti and Aditi. Both had been our very bright MPhil students in Calcutta University. Actually, I have indicated that Turkish tribes had been, certain Turkish tribes had been matriarchal. Even when the women had been very young, they were put on horseback so that they developed the skill to ride a horse. So masculinity was associated in their grooming. In their grooming process, masculinity had been associated. So in this way, some of the Turkish tribes, you have to understand that Turkish situation was different from Arab situation. It was different from entirely desert situation. So you understand the camp life, the domination of males in a desert situation masculinity is very important in a desert situation, and the Turkish were very ambulatory people. They were not regional. They had to move from one place to another because of their ambulatory nature. Even if you remember the Mughals would be, they were Turks. Mughals were Turks. They would be moving with their camps. That is almost the capital city is moving along the Mughals. This is the case. If you see the film Jodha Akbar, you will understand that a camp, it's a civilization of moving camp. So experience is different. Under such circumstances, women had to be empowered. If you see Mughal paintings, you will find that women were featuring in Mughal paintings. So in this way, the Turkish people came in India in large numbers, but not the Arab-speaking people. Arabs came, but not in large numbers. But Turkish people came, Iranians came, Central Asians came. So this Turkish habit of matriarchal, preserving a matriarchal society became prominent. So, and most of the Sufis were had Turkish origin, like Nizamuddin Hawliya himself. So in this way, Turkish practices became prominent among the Sufis, and that coincided with theological practices of the Sufis, which was also favorably disposed towards the women. Regarding Aditi's question, yes, I would say that it's not a monolithic situation. Position of women or respectability of women can vary from Dorga to Dorga. You can find in some Dorgas where women are distanced from the Majar. Women are asked to maintain a distance from the Majar. There would be Dorgas also where women came to enjoy a greater amount of mobility, greater amount of freedom. So there's an element of heterogeneity so far as treatment unleashed towards the women followers in the Dorga. It depends on the silsila, I would say. Some of the silsilas are very comparatively conservative. Some of the silsilas are very, very liberal or comparatively liberal. And the second factor responsible for this varied gesture towards women is that local culture. Sometimes local culture allows women to be more ambulatory, more mobile. For example, look at Bengal. In Bengal, women can move more freely because of certain agricultural or agrarian habits, eco-geographical habits. So these sort of factors played a crucial role. So it's a monolith, not a monolithic structure. Position of women varied from Dorga to Dorga. Sometimes they enjoyed a greater amount of freedom. Sometimes they were not allowed that freedom because of the local existing custom, local tradition. Thank you for your question, Aditi. Any other question?
Thank you, sir. There are some more questions, but the time is so short. So I think maybe these questions can be later considered after the completion of the second lecture that is there.
Definitely.
So for the time being, I think we should be moving on to the second lecture. Thank you again, sir, for such brilliant and well-researched lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Our next speaker is Dr. Aparna Bandyopadhyay, and her lecture is titled Towards the History of Intimate Relation in Colonial Bengal, Problems and Perspectives. Now, a brief introduction to Dr. Bandyopadhyay. Actually, it's not so brief because she also has a huge and very impressive resume. Dr. Aparna Bandyopadhyay is an associate professor in history at Diamond Harbor Women's University, West Bengal. She was formerly an associate professor in history in the West Bengal Education Service and has served several government colleges, including Lady Brabourne College, Kolkata. She was awarded a doctoral degree from Jadavpur University, Kolkata in 2012. Her book titled Desire and Defiance, A Study of Bengali Women in Love, 1850 to 1930, based on a doctoral dissertation, was published by Orient Black Swan in 2016. She has also co-edited two anthologies on women's studies. She completed a UGC-sponsored research project on A Leisure of Women's Own, Television, Mega Serials, and Bengali Women in Contemporary Kolkata. This is actually a very interesting title and topic also. She's currently co-editing her story, a fetch script for Professor Geraldine Forbes. Her research interests include the social history of colonial Bengal with a focus on social reform, women's everyday lives, violence, love, and leisure. She's also interested in women's writings. Dr. Bandyopadhyay has presented papers in many international and national conferences. She has also published a large number of articles in journals and edited volumes. And readers can follow her work interested people in academy.edu. So I hand over the floor to Dr. Apurna Bondhopadhyay.
Thank you, Dr. Dibukpriyo Shannal. Thank you very much for that introduction. I feel humbled. And it's a great honor for me to be invited to this webinar and sharing this platform. Yes, it's a web platform, but it is a platform all the same with Professor Omidda. Our dear Omidda, it's really an honor for me. And Omidda, I followed your lecture. I listened with rapt attention. And as usual, I'm overawed by your presentation. I'm overawed by your erudition. I'm overawed by your concept of imaginary intellectual. Well, this is one concept that I've borrowed from you, and I apply it in different contexts. And wonderful. And you speak with so much of passion. I really envy your passion. I'm really overwhelmed by your passion. Thank you very much, Professor Omidde, and my heartfelt thanks to to Professor Manjuri Chakraborty, head of the Department of History, Surendranath Evely College, for inviting me to be a part of this webinar. I heartily thank Moumita Dashgupta. She's also a faculty of the Department of History of this college. I've also interacted with her at an earlier webinar in a different college. So she's also a very enthusiastic person, a very very enthusiastic organizer, and my thanks also to all the other teachers of this college, and a very very good afternoon to the audience, to all the participants. So I'll be speaking on towards the history of intimate relations in colonial Bengal, problems and perspectives. Now, let me qualify my title at the outset. I'll be speaking on the history of heterosexual intimate relations in colonial Bengal. And I'll be speaking on women's perceptions, women's experiences of heterosexual intimacy in colonial in Bengal, and by thus redefining the title of my lecture, I will link a history of intimacy, a history of intimate relations with women's history. Now, common sense tells us that intimacy, or rather heterosexual intimacy, is about men and women. This cannot be a matter that concerns women alone or women exclusively. But then why am I interested in women's perceptions of intimacy, women's perceptions of heterosexual intimacy? Intimacy, yes, it is something, something which appears to be above patriarchy, beyond patriarchal control, beyond hierarchies, beyond discrimination, beyond inequality. But no, actually, intimacy is very much mired in inequality, mired in hierarchy, and it is embedded in patriarchy. And so women's experiences within heterosexual intimacy are bound to be different from men's experiences within intimate relations. Okay. Yes, sir. Am I audible? I think there's no problem with sound. Okay. Yes. So that is what makes me interested in the history of women's emotions, perceptions, sensibilities, their experiences with regard to heterosexual intimacy in the context of colonial Bengal. I further define my project or my agenda today. I'm constrained, I have time constraints, and I have also constraints of knowledge. I am not in a position to talk about the experiences of Muslim women, even though I would love to talk about it. Professor Amit Day has talked about at length about women in medieval India, Muslim women in medieval India, and also Muslim women in colonial Bengal and in colonial India at large. And she did refer to Rokia Hossain and some other Muslim women. But in order to, yes, I have read Rokia, but in order to give a clear picture of what Muslim women thought about intimacy, I need to read more of women's writings. For instance, Professor Amit Day had mentioned Mir Musharraf Hussain and his works. Mir Musharraf Hussain had written in the 1870s. And in 1876, one Muslim woman had written a novel named Rup Jalal. Okay. And this book is supposed to, this novel is supposed to deal with polygamy, about marriage and all other issues. So I would have love to know from Professor Day Nawab Faizun Nisa, author of Rup Jalal, and other Muslim writers of this period thought about heterosexual intimacy. I'd have loved to explore that, but for the time being, I will confine my discussion to Bengali Hindu and Brahmo women, because I've read their writings. I've tried to read their writings, and I've tried also to look at various archival sources in order to in the first place to write a social history of love, and that was my project for my PhD, a social history of love. And now I've tried after the completion of my PhD dissertation, I've tried to comprehend what Hindu and Brahmo Bengali women thought about, what they felt about intimacy, their relationship with their lovers, with their husbands, and how they articulated their feelings, their ideas in their writings, in various genres of writings. Okay, so I wanted to retrieve women's own voices in this regard. Okay, I want to know the women's side of the story and retrieve their own voices, revealing their desires, ecstasies, agonies, and anguish. I want to know what they felt about and experienced within premarital romance, within conjugality, and beyond it. I want to know how widows responded to their widowhood, what they felt about the denials that widowhood normally entailed in Hindu society, their unfulfilled desires, their emotional involvements after they lost their husbands. I mean, subsequent emotional involvements, post-widowhood emotional involvements. I wish to explore the mindscapes. Actually, I want to explore the mindscapes of women, unearth their emotional turbulence, their dilemmas, their everyday acts of resistance, and also find out what they expected from conjugality, felt about the norms of marriage, norms of widowhood, and how they also reacted to the violence that generally pervaded conjugal intimacy. However, I'm constrained by a lack of sources. My forays into official documents, newspaper reports, and judicial papers of this period do reveal a discriminatory and relentless punitive regime, gruesome incidents of violence, of abortions that did not remain secret, desertion of illegitimate children, suicide, and sensational court trials. However, these give little access to women's own voices, revealing what they felt about and experienced within intimate relations. Now, in order to delve into the minds of women who lived and had relationships with men in the colonial era, I decided at the outset to look up autobiographies and memoirs spent by women in this period. Now, the spread of education among women since the middle of the 19th century had enabled the emergence of the category of the lekhika, as aptly pointed out by Tonika Sarkar. Now, women wrote almost everything under the sun. They wrote letters and essays in newspapers and periodicals. They wrote travelogues. They published manuals and monographs in the non-fictional format. They wrote novels, short stories, and poems. They also indulged in self-writing, penning autobiographies, memoirs, and diaries. Now, some Bengali women writing themselves have been remarkably candid about the premarital courtship they had enjoyed with their would-be husbands. Instances of such candid self-revelation are Indira Devi Chaudhurani's Shriti Shamput, Shanta Devi's Purbo Shriti, Leela Mojumdar's Pak Dondi, Pratibha Bosu's Jibonir Jol Chobi, etc. Others. There are many others. Now, these women mostly belong to educated Brahmo or Hindu upper caste middle class families. They were all respectable women, or Bhadra Mohila, as they were called, as they were referred to. Their marriages had worked well, and at an advanced age, they had begun to nostalgically recount their days of premarital courtship. The point of entry into a successful and prosperous conjugal life. Interestingly, these accounts of premarital romance were thoroughly desexualized and sanitized, almost platonic. Now, Prosannamoyi Devi, a child widow with no opportunity for remarriage, briefly alluded to her unfulfilled desires in her autobiography Purbo Katha. Jyotirmoyi Devi, she was a novelist writing in the 1930s, 40s. Jyotirmoyi Devi was widowed in the early 20s. Now, she was to practice austere widowhood the rest of her life. She expressed in her autobiography, Sriti Visriti Torongo, we could also call these memoirs. Instead of autobiographies, we could call them Sriti Kathas or memoirs. Now, in Sriti Visriti Torongo, Jyotirmoyi Devi expressed her dilemmas and a sense of guilt about exchanging letters with a male friend who had inspired her to write. Apart from these brief slippages, no widow reminiscing about her early life has recorded her cravings or recounted her frustrations or her subsequent relationships. Finally, no married woman writing a memoir or autobiography in this period revealed her unhappiness or frustrations within conjugality or any extramarital involvement. Evidently, revealing one's unhappiness within conjugality or extramarital desires was incompatible with one's respectability. And none of these women seeking to write their own life narratives could violate this basic premise of their social existence. And so my efforts to write a history of intimacy on the basis of women's own voices ran almost into a dead end. Now, at that point of time, I came across Hoimavati Sen's Because I Am a Woman. Now, Hoimavati Sen's memoir, discovered and published long after her death, laid bare a horrifying saga of marital oppression, deception, and exploitation in her brief conjugal life with a middle-aged deputy magistrate of Jashore, a saga that did not significantly change even after her second marriage to the Brahmo reformer Kunjo Bihari Sen. The manuscript was unearthed by one of Hoimavati's granddaughters, who handed it over to Geraldine Forbes in the 1990s. Tapan Roy Choudhury translated the manuscript, and the duo published the manuscript with an introduction. Now, Hoimavati was married off at the age of 12. With a man with several children from her previous marriages. Her husband would sleep with local sex workers in their bedroom. Hoimavati would tremble in fear. Her trauma led to occasional bouts of nervous collapse. Her husband's eventual death spared her more torment and moreover prodded her to embark on a journey that culminated in her self-establishment as a doctor with a flourishing practice. In the meantime, she had married a second time, this time supposedly a progressive man. The second marriage turned out to be even more troubled. Kunjo Bihari Sen was dishonest, irresponsible, and abusive. He was driven out of his job on account of alleged financial irregularity. He became a mendicant for some time. He fathered several children, but shirked all responsibility. He seized control over Hoimavati's income. Whenever Hoimavati earned a few extra rupees from her professional visits, she had to conceal this fact from her husband. He even beat her up from time to time. Her first husband had spared her by dying, but her second husband made her life living hell. At her workplace, Hoimavati refused to compromise and protested at the slightest instance of injustice. At home, however, she had accepted male authority, a fact also observed by Geraldine Forbes. She became an obedient wife to her second husband. She acknowledged Kunjo Bihari as her master and allowed him to make crucial decisions for them both. She even bore domestic violence without much protest. However, this fact, we should acknowledge that Hoimavati did not try to hide the unsavory details of her conjugal life from the public eye, nor did she try to glorify him unduly. And in this way, she left behind a manuscript, which, as Geraldine Forbes rightly observes, is extraordinary for its descriptions of the burdens of a woman's life and details of marital conflict. Now, my queries regarding women's perceptions of intimacy, experiences within intimacy, were more satisfactorily answered once I turned my attention to diaries, or dinolipi, as they were called in Bengali, penned by Bengali women in this period. Now, autobiographies represented a process of scripting of self in conformity with the expectations of the reading public. The author had in mind that the autobiography would eventually be published and therefore was hesitant about exposing her intimate inner self in writing. A dinolipi or a diary was a form of scripting of self more candid and honest to oneself, as it was not meant for a reading audience. Writing a diary was a more spontaneous exercise, usually unstructured and unself-conscious, unmediated by an anxiety to project oneself and others in a favorable light. A diary laid bare the inner recesses of the author's psyche, the intricate layers of her subjectivity, in a more poignant manner. The practice of diary has started in 18th century Europe as a form of confession written to relieve guilt. But it was appropriated by Bengali women in the 19th and early 20th centuries to record the trivialities of their everyday existence and also to release and relieve their minds. The diaries of Dinolipis that I've come across from this era reveal that women did not always conform to the model of unquestioning conjugality and ascetic widowhood so zealously upheld by the polemical literature of the time. Diaries expose that women did not passively internalize the nationalist construct of womanhood, even though their autobiographies might tell a different story. Now, Omnubala's diary. This is a. The date of publication, original publication, is not known, but it has been included in Ondorer Itihash Nari Jobanmundi. Volume 2, compilation of women's autobiographies was edited by Ohona Bishash and Proshun Ghosh and published by Gangchil in 2016. Now, Omnubala had been married at the age of 16 to the son of an affluent aristocratic family. Her father had tried his best to educate his daughter and gone beyond his means to arrange a marriage to the son of an affluent aristocratic family. For 3 months after her marriage, Omnubala enjoyed conjugal bliss. Differences over dowry, however, abruptly terminated her blissful conjugality. Omnia's mother-in-law and her husband made it clear that they would not accept Omnubala unless her father paid a sum of 3,000 rupees. Omnia's father was unable to hand over the demanded amount, and Omnia was discarded forever. An exorbitant monetary demand was compounded with innumerable baseless allegations, such as Omnubala was suffering from female disease or male rogue, was not adequately educated, did not know how to sing and play the harmonium, etc. Initially, Omnubala was optimistic that her husband would take her back, but later she lost hope and sank into deep depression. She eventually died after a brief illness. Her father, unable to bear the trauma, died soon after. Now, Omnubala's diary was handed over to the editor of Manushya Mormobani after her death. Omnubala, it appears, was deeply in love with her husband. And that love did not fade away even after he discarded her. Yet, she did not hesitate to criticize her husband for making a mockery of the vows of lifelong togetherness he had made at the time of their wedding. She expressed her deep sense of hurt at the injustice he had inflicted on her and criticized him for his insensitivity. Now let me come to Subarna Prabha Das. She was the daughter of the Brahmo couple Sharada Manjari Datta and Nabagopal Datta. Now Subarna Prabha was indoctrinated in Brahmoism from her childhood and was enamored of the Brahmo conception of conjugality as a spiritual union of souls. Betrothed to Premanand Das, son of Sundari Mohan Das, another stalwart of the Brahmo Samaj, Subarna Prabha dreamt that the Brahmo ideal of conjugality would be fulfilled in her own life. After Premanando returned from America on completing higher studies, they got married. Their conjugal life, however, turned out to be a far cry from the ideal she had cherished. Subarna Prabha's diary unravels her disillusionment, her agony and anguish at Premanando's indifference, at his tendency to oppress her mentally and play the blame game on the slightest pretext. Amidst a turbulent conjugality, Subarna Prabha bore several children. Evidently, there was a stark gap between precept and practice. Beneath Premanando's progressive veneer lurked a patriarchal mindset, insensitivity, and double standards. His behavior often left Subarna Prabha weeping day and night. On 13th April 1915, Subarna Prabha wrote in her dinolipi, "Shokal theke kebol aaj chokhe jol bhore utheche. Keno je ta to devota tomar ajana nei. Amar deher shokti moner bol boro kom. Tai shob kaj ekshonge kore utte pari na. Tai koto rokom kotha shunte hoy. Sokoler kothay shojjo kori tobe tumi kichu bolle ar shoyte pari na. Boro koshto hoy. তুমি তো বেশ জানো এবং এও জানো যে আমি বড় সেনসিটিভ, তবুও যখন এমন করো তখন আর আমার কথা কে বুঝবে? কার মুখ চেয়ে বাড়ি ঘর মা বাবা সবাইকে ছেড়ে এত দূরে এসেছি? সংসার পাতবার আগে বড় আশা ছিল, আর কেউ আমায় ক্ষমা না করলেও তুমি আমায় ক্ষমা করে চলবে এবং তাতেই আমি কাজ করবার প্রেরণা পাব। কিন্তু এখন দেখছি সেসব আমার স্বপ্ন, বাস্তবে তা সবসময় হয় না। দেবতা তুমি আমায় স্পর্শ করে থাকো, তোমার স্নেহ ক্রোড়ে আমায় রাখো, তবে আর মানুষের ব্যবহারের জন্য এত মন আমার ব্যাকুল হবে না। নাও লেট মি গো অন টু নিরুপমা দেবী। নাও নিরুপমা দেবী ওয়াজ এ চাইল্ড উইডো, শি ওয়াজ ম্যারিড এট দ্য এজ অফ 10 টু নবগোপাল ভট্ট অ্যান্ড ওয়াজ উইডোড এট দ্য এজ অফ 14। She led a life of extreme austerity. The rest of her life, she did not marry. She became obsessed with pujos and vratos and all. That was much later, but her immediate post-widowhood years were spent at Bhagolpur. And it was here that she met Sharadchandra Chattopadhyay. And Sharadchandra is supposed to have fallen in love with her. And Nirupama's rude rebuff is known to have changed the course of Sharadchandra's life. And remained touch with each other, even though they did not formalize their relationship. They exchanged letters and Sharadchandra was more candid about his relationship with Nirupama Devi. The fact that he liked her, he did not try to keep it secret, when he was very open about it. And that caused quite a lot of embarrassment to Nirupama Devi. But wasn't Nirupama Devi in love with Sharadchandra as well? Didn't she reciprocate Sharadchandra's feelings? Now, we've got a few pages of our diary. Chitrarekha Gupta, she was a professor of archaeology department. And then she started researching in 19th century women's history. Early 20th century women's history. Now, Chitrarekha Gupta was fortunate enough in getting a few pages of Nirupama's diary. Now, if you read those pages, actually, I've got the Bengali version of the Bengali original Bengali book, but I've misplaced it, and so I cannot read out the original Bengali text. I've translated those words earlier. I translated them earlier, and so I'll read out the translations. On 7th Ashar, 1908, Nirupama Devi wrote, "This immense downpour of tears will drive the earth to which whirlpool of desires? God, don't let it be so. Pull me to yourself, my ocean. Pull me towards you. Don't let my trivial desires prevail over you. My pacific ocean, don't be so indifferent. If you attract me towards you, this water current will not deviate elsewhere." Evidently, Nirupama was fighting with herself to suppress her desires. On the same day, she penned the following lines in poetry. on this dark night of monsoon, my mind cannot concentrate on work. My eyes are flooded with tears. Why did the saint mendicant come to my doorstep? Why did he play his veena with such pathos? Whenever I come and go, my eyes fall on his face. I do not know whether to call him or rebuff him. These torn pages of Nirupama's diary hint at an emotional state that was torn between contrary pulls and dilemmas. They suggest that, yes, Nirupama probably had to fight daily battles within to achieve a state of equanimity. Now let me come to the poet Priyambada Devi. Priyambada's diary, a notebook, as she called it, was really a revelation for me. Now Priyambada Devi was daughter of Prashannamoyi Devi, and her mother was also a child widow. And Priyambada Devi lost both her husband and son early in life. She eventually developed a friendship with the Japanese artist and writer Okakura Kakuzo. Now, a friendship that became more and more passionate each day. And it could have matured into the marital turn. But everything was aborted by Okakura's sudden and untimely death barely after a year after they met. The restraint that Priyambada exercised in her letters to Okakura was strikingly missing in her notebook, which recorded the spontaneous, uninhibited, and passionate outpourings of this widow poet's yearning for Okakura. Priyambada has made these notebook entries in English. Okay. Now, her entries since November 1912 record the evolution of her feelings towards Okakura. Initially, all she could offer was friendship and affection. Now, on 6 November 1912, Priyambada wrote, "What is your need, dear friend? What would you have of me? Love, the delicate flower of a season, bearing the charm of blushing dawn, filled with nectar, pure with dew, enthralling with scent, will not bloom out of its time, and I am helpless in pain. My heart cries out against refusal and cannot let you go empty-handed. Will you then accept of me affection, not the product of offspring of a season, but the growth of a lifetime, and be my friend and foster brother for good?" But love was surreptitiously and irresistibly creeping into Priyambada's existence. Now, on 17 November, she wrote, "Why should the thoughts of a stranger scarcely known who came into my life just for one twilight hour haunt me so all throughout the day? Does he think of me too, or with hankering in his heart try to span the distant void and reach my unceasing dreams?" A few days later, she wrote, "I may not perhaps show you the fleshy bulk, but don't I reveal the soul of it in my eyes? Can't you read the poems written there through them and see the light that never shone on any sky or sea but there?" On 9 June 1913, Priyambada was completely overpowered by a longing for Okakura. "Ah, why did you break my life with your longing? My past is gone. The present is quite absent, and I can build not my future, try as I would." Okakura died on 2nd September 2013. Now, on 11 September, Priyambada expressed herself thus: "Was it just a year ago we met, or was it eons before? What karma kept us apart so long? What will again bring us together? On 12 September, Priyangvada imagined herself in a bridal state, invested with marital insignia by her departed lover. She wrote, "With the point of thy sharp-edged sword, thou hast put the vermilion mark on my forehead, in lacquer red painted my feet, and with memory's fast iron wristlet, thou hast claimed me, beloved, as thy bride for eternity." On 15 September, she expressed her yearning for everlasting union by penning the following lines. "The anniversary of our meeting of a year ago comes tomorrow. Would that be the final consummation, the union everlasting?" Now, with such passionate and soulful articulations, the romance between this young widow and the Japanese scholar comes alive on the pages of the former's notebook. Diaries penned by women are indispensable tools in the toolbox of a historian trying to write a history of intimate relations, women's own understanding, perception of intimate relations in colonial Bengal. They are more useful than autobiographies because they were entirely meant for cathartic self-release and were supposed to be spontaneous expressions of a woman's emotions. Much of what remained unsaid in autobiographies became explicit in diaries. Diaries are maybe very useful for creating an archive of emotions in colonial Bengal. But not all women have left behind diaries. I've got only a few diaries. I could leave my hand upon only a few diaries. Okay. So what would be my point of entry into the mindscapes of women, the turbulent mindscapes of women? How can I access their mental universe? তাদের যে মানস লোক, তাদের যে মন, মনের যে জগৎ, অন্তরের যে জগৎ, সেই জগৎটাকে আমি ছুঁব কি করে, ধরব কি করে? হ্যাঁ, আত্মজীবনীতে মেয়েরা তো তাদের ভেতরের কথা বলতে চায়নি, খুব স্বাভাবিকভাবেই তারা তাদের যে ভাবমূর্তি এবং তাদের প্রিয়জনদের, মানে স্বামী অথবা শ্বশুর মশাই, এদের ভাবমূর্তি বজায় রাখতে সংযত থেকেছে। মানে তারা যে কথাগুলো বলতে হয়তো চেয়েছিল সে কথা বলতে পারেনি, অনেক কথা হয়তো তাদের বলার ছিল কিন্তু তারা প্রকাশ্যে সেগুলো আনতে পারেনি। আর ডায়েরি বা নোটবুক কতজনেই বা লিখে, কিন্তু যে কজন লিখেছে, যে কটা ডায়েরি আমরা আলোচনা করলাম, আর সেগুলো কিন্তু প্রত্যেকটাই মানে যেন একটা অদ্ভুত, মানে একটা জগৎকে উন্মোচন করলো, একটা অদ্ভুত মনোজগৎকে উন্মোচন করলো। এবং মানে ডায়েরির মধ্যে দিয়ে যেন এই এই মহিলারা তাদের মনের যে যে ফ্ল্যাট গেট গুলো খুলে দিয়েছে। কারণ তারা ভেবেছে খুব স্বাভাবিক ভাবে যে ডায়েরি গুলো তো তারা গোপনে লিখছে এবং এগুলো তো কেউ পড়বে না, কিন্তু হ্যাঁ, তাদের মৃত্যুর পর অবশ্যই এই ডায়েরি গুলো পরবর্তী প্রজন্মের গবেষকদের কাছে, পাঠক পাঠিকাদের হাতে এসেছে, এবং এই ডায়েরি গুলোর সূত্র ধরে আমরা এদের মনের মানে মনের ভেতরে প্রবেশ করতে পেরেছি। কিন্তু তাও যেন মানে কত কিছু অজানা রয়ে যায়, খুব সামান্যই জানতে পারি। তাহলে এবার আমাদের সোর্স কি হবে? মানে একটা সোর্স থেকে আরেকটা সোর্সে আমরা যাচ্ছি। আসলে এইটা ইন্টিমেট রিলেশনস এর ইতিহাস লেখার এটাই তো সমস্যা। আমাদের সোর্স কি হবে, আমাদের আমাদের মানে তথ্য সূত্র কি হবে? আর্কাইভে যে ধরনের ডকুমেন্টস থাকে, সেই ডকুমেন্টস গুলো তো মেয়েদের মনের কথা বলে না, অন্তর্জগতের কথা বলে না। তো তাহলে আমরা আমরা কিভাবে জানবো? তো এবার আমি যে সোর্সের কথা বলবো সেটা হচ্ছে মেয়েদের লেখা উপন্যাস। হ্যাঁ, এবং আমি বলতে চাই যে মেয়েরা উপন্যাসের মাধ্যমে অনেকটাই নিজেদের মেলে ধরেছে। সোনামে মানে মানে উপস্থিত হয়নি, মানে তাদের লেখায় অবশ্যই সে মানে লেখিকা তার নিজের নামে নিজেকে প্রকাশ করেনি, তার চরিত্রের নাম দিয়ে এবং চরিত্রের মধ্যে ঢুকে গিয়ে আসলে নিজেকেই প্রকাশ করেছে, নিজেকেই তুলে ধরেছে। এবং আমি প্রথমে মৈত্রেয়ী দেবীর ও নহন্যতের কথা বলবো। নহন্যতে অনেকেই আপনারা নিশ্চয়ই পড়েছেন এবং নহন্যতে কিন্তু কিন্তু নভেল হিসেবে মানে এটাকে যখন মানে বইয়ের যে যদি টাইটেল পেজেস বা আখ্যান পত্র যদি আমরা দেখি তাহলে ইট হ্যাজ বিন রিপ্রেজেন্টেড অ্যাজ এ নভেল, মানে লেখিকা নিজে এটাকে নভেল হিসেবেই উপস্থাপিত করেছে। 1974 সালে উনি এটা লেখেন, কিন্তু আমরা এটা সবাই জানি যে এটা আসলে মৈত্রেয়ী দেবী নিজের কথা। এবং এখানে নামগুলো একটু একটু পাল্টেছেন, যেমন মৈত্রীর বদলে অমৃতা, মিথ্যা সারনেমটা একটু চেঞ্জ হয়েছে, এছাড়াও বাবার নামটাও চেঞ্জ হয়েছে। হ্যাঁ, তো কিন্তু মানে ঘটনাগুলো একই, মানে ওই অমৃতার সঙ্গে মির্চার যে প্রেম সেটা আসলে মৈত্রেয়ী দেবী এবং মির্চা যেভাবে প্রোনাউন্স করি না কেন, মির্চা এলিয়ডের প্রেমের প্রেমেরই কথা। এবং মৈত্রেয়ী দেবীর বাবা এই প্রেমের ঘোরতর বিরোধী ছিলেন এবং মির্চাকে বলেন বাড়ি ছেড়ে চলে যেতে। এবং তারপরে মৈত্রেয়ী দেবী খুব অসুস্থ হয়ে পড়েন এবং তিনি আত্মহত্যা করার কথাও ভাবেন। তো এই যে আমরা এই উপন্যাসটা থেকে যেটা উপন্যাস কাম আত্মজীবনী মূলক উপন্যাস থেকে আমরা আসলে অনেক কিছুই জানতে পারি। আমরা এই যে যন্ত্রণা একটা নিয়ে যন্ত্রণা এবং তার মনের ওপর, তার জীবনের ওপর, তার অভিভাবকের নিয়ন্ত্রণের যে ধরনটা এবং সেই মানে তার পিতার ওই দ্বিচারিতা, তিনি নিজে কিন্তু বিবাহ বহির্ভূত সম্পর্কে ইনভলভ ছিলেন কিন্তু তার মেয়ের জীবনকে তিনি খুব এমন ভাবে কন্ট্রোল করছেন যে মানে মেয়েকে পুরোপুরি একেবারে তার মানে খেলার পুতুল হিসেবে তিনি দেখছেন। তো এবং মৈত্রেয়ী দেবীর যে যন্ত্রণা সেই যন্ত্রণাটা এই অমৃতার বয়ানে প্রকাশ পেয়েছে। তাহলে অ্যাকচুয়ালি এটা ইউ ক্যান কল ইট এ ফিকশনালাইজ অটোবায়োগ্রাফি অর অ্যান অটোবায়োগ্রাফিক্যাল ফিকশন। এবং এটার মধ্যে দিয়ে একটা একটা মেয়ের যে মানে একটা একটা প্রেমে যে আঘাত এবং মানে তার কিছু অভিভাবকের যে নিয়ন্ত্রণের ফলে তার এই ব্যর্থতা, প্রেমের যে ব্যর্থতা, যে বিচ্ছেদের যে যন্ত্রণা সেটা আমরা খুঁজে পাই। এবার নিরুপমা দেবীর একটা দুটো, আমি জানি না আর কত সময় আছে, তাহলে আমি নিরুপমা দেবীর একটা দুটো উপন্যাস নিয়ে একটু আলোচনা করতে চাই। নিরুপমা দেবীর কথা আমি আগে বলেছি, তার ডায়েরির কথা বলেছি, এবার ফিউ অফ আ নভেলস এর আমি কথা বলতে চাই। নভেল গুলোর কথা আমি ঠিক আছে আমার সময়ের অভাবে আমি ছেড়েই দিলাম, কিন্তু আমি একটা ছোট গল্পের কথা বলতে চাই। ছোট গল্পটার নাম প্রায়শ্চিত্ত। নিরুপমা দেবী বাল বিধবা, তিনি আর দ্বিতীয়বার বিয়ে করেননি। হ্যাঁ, সারা জীবন বৈধব্যে সুচিতা বজায় রেখে গেছেন এবং সব রকম কঠোর নিয়ম কানুন পালন করে গেছেন, কিন্তু তার এই ছোট গল্পের যে প্রোটাগনিস্ট নীরজা, সে নীরজা কিন্তু বিধবা, কিন্তু সে দ্বিতীয়বার বিবাহিত হচ্ছে। আমি এটা খুব সংক্ষেপে ইংলিশে এই গল্পটার একটা সামারি দিয়ে দিই। আই থিঙ্ক দেয়ার আর মেনি অ্যামাং দ্য পার্টিসিপেন্টস হু ক্যানট ফলো বেঙ্গলি ভেরি ওয়েল, এই জন্যই আজকে আমার প্রেজেন্টেশনটা মূলত আমি ইংলিশেই করেছি। Niroja was forced into an arranged marriage by her grandfather at her infancy. She became a widow a few months after her marriage. Shortly after this, her parents relocated to Calcutta and Niroja was admitted to school. Now, all the markers of widowhood were erased from her life. Years later, she came to know one Mohit. Now, they fell in love with each other and got married, defying the objections raised by their respective families. Niroja, however, was not destined to enjoy lasting conjugal bliss. Mohit died a few years after marriage, leaving Niroja and the little daughter in an abject state of penury. At this stage, Niroja was overpowered by a sense of guilt. Has she committed a sin by remarrying, or was she being punished for this sin? When she herself was on the verge of death, her grandfather, now struck with remorse, arrived by her side, declaring that Niroja's remarriage had been a perfectly valid one. It was he himself who should suffer penance for his sin of inflicting an early marriage on Niroja, and this he would by taking her child into his custody. তাহলে নীরজার মনে হচ্ছে যে সে শাস্তি পেয়েছে, মানে দ্বিতীয়বার বিয়ে করার জন্য সে শাস্তি পেয়েছে, তাই তার দ্বিতীয় স্বামীও মারা গেছে। হ্যাঁ, কিন্তু একটা প্রবল অপরাধ বোধে সে ভুগছে, এবং এই দ্বিতীয় বিয়ের কারণে তার পরিবার, তার স্বামীর পরিবারও তাদের ছেড়ে চলে গেছে, তারা কেউ তাদের পাশে থাকেনি। কিন্তু শেষে নীরজার দাদামশাই এসে বলছে না, তিনি অন্যায় করেছিলেন। হ্যাঁ, এবং তিনি তারই মানে প্রায়শ্চিত্ত যদি কাউকে করতে হয় তাকেই করতে হয়। তো তাহলে আমি যেটা বলতে চাইছি যে একজন বিধবা যিনি নিজের জীবনে দ্বিতীয়বার বিয়ে করার কথা ভাবেননি, যদিও হয়তো শরৎচন্দ্র চট্টোপাধ্যায়ের সঙ্গে তার একটা 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 হৃদয়ের একটা আদান প্রদান ছিল, কিন্তু তার গল্পের মাধ্যমে কিন্তু তিনি তার যে অপূর্ণ যে চাওয়াটা সেটা তিনি পূরণ করছেন, এবং এটা যে অন্যায় চাওয়া নয় সেই কথাটা তিনি বলছেন। এবার আশালতা সিংহের কথা আসে, ইনিও আরেক ভীষণ ট্র্যাজিক একজন লেখিকা। আশালতা সিংহের এক প্রেম ছিল হেমেন্দ্রলাল রায়ের সঙ্গে, শি ওয়াজ ইন লাভ উইথ হেমেন্দ্রলাল রায়, বাট ম্যারেজ ওয়াজ ডিনাইড বাই দেয়ার রেসপেক্টিভ ফ্যামিলিজ অন অ্যাকাউন্ট অফ কাস্ট ডিফারেন্সেস। নাও ইভেন্টুয়ালি সাবজেক্টেড টু অ্যান অ্যারেঞ্জ ম্যারেজ, Ashalata suffered a deeply turbulent marital life. She remained in touch with her lover, a fact that her husband found out. Humiliated and oppressed in many ways, she tried to break away and even made several failed attempts at suicide. There was no escape for her, however, and she had to eventually settle down with her husband and in-laws. Now, making her debut in the literary arena at the age of 16 with Amitar Prem, a novel which was reasonably appreciated by Rabindranath Tagore. You know that Rabindranath Tagore would very rarely speak well of women's writings, but he did praise Ashalata Shingo for her maiden novel Amitar Prem. Now, Ashalata persisted in her literary pursuits for some years in face of tremendous hostility from her marital family. Dorja bondho kore likhte hoto, haan, shoshur barite. Amra khub shombhranto jomidar poribare tar biye hoyechilo, ebong tar shami ekjon doctor, ebong tar shami ওই সমকালীন একজন দুজন লেখককে উস্কে দিয়েছিলেন তার বিরুদ্ধে, তারা তার বিরুদ্ধে মানে বিভিন্ন খুব একটু তাকে অসম্মান করে কবিতা লিখেছিলেন, যেমন ওই বনফুল তাকে নিয়ে একটা কবিতা লিখেছিলেন, সেটা ওই সজনীকান্ত দাসের শনিবারের চিঠিতে প্রকাশিত হয়েছিল। মানে খুবই খারাপ, মানে স্বামীর সঙ্গে সম্পর্ক একদমই ভালো ছিল না, এবং তার লেখালেখিও বন্ধ হয়ে যায় 26 বছর পরে। তারপরে তিনি লেখেন থেকেও দু চারটে খুব মানে ধর্মীয় গ্রন্থ ছাড়া, মানে তিনি যে অসাধারণ একটা উপন্যাস সৃষ্টি করেছেন, মানে সেই মানে তার যে সৃজনশীলতার উৎস মুখটা কিন্তু রুদ্ধ হয়ে যায়। তার কয়েকটা উপন্যাস, অনেকগুলো উপন্যাস কথা বলা যায়, কিন্তু আমি একটার কথা আমি বিশেষ করে বলবো, যেটা খুব পরিষ্কার ভাবে অটোবায়োগ্রাফিক্যাল, মানে আত্মজৈবনিক উপাদান যার মধ্যে রয়েছে, খুব প্রোনাউন্সড অটোবায়োগ্রাফিক্যাল এলিমেন্টস, যেটা হচ্ছে জীবনধারা। জীবনধারার যে লিডিং ফিমেল প্রোটাগনিস্ট এশা, এশা হ্যাড বিন অ্যাভার্স টু দ্য আইডিয়া অফ রোম্যান্স অ্যান্ড কোর্টশিপ বিফোর ম্যারেজ অ্যান্ড হ্যাড স্পার্নড দেবেশ হু ওয়াজ ইন লাভ উইথ হার। Now, enamored of the ideology of Shotitto, of a wife's unquestioning surrender and loyalty to her husband, Esha entered an arranged marriage with a man hailing from a rural aristocratic family. After marriage, however, her husband's grossness and insensitivity and the oppressive atmosphere in her marital household so shocked Esha that she found it impossible to live up to her self-imposed commitment to the ideals of Shokitto and Patibroto. When she could take it no longer, she returned to her parents, only to be reminded by her father and other relatives that she could not retrace her steps once she had tied the knot. The marriage bond was indissoluble, and she had no other option at that juncture but to go back to her husband. It was a woman's duty. She was taught to efface her selfhood and surrender her unquestioningly to her husband and her marital family. Isha did so, but her earlier exuberance and naive expectations had been replaced by a stoical acceptance of existing circumstances. She realized rather painfully that she had actually sought love and understanding, even though she had not admitted it, and her quest would remain unfulfilled in this life. Now, writing fiction to these women authors was evidently a release of their pent-up agonies, a quest for the resolution of their dilemmas, their inner conflict. It was also a means of fulfilling desires and aspirations unrealizable in their own lives. Now, fiction was a kind of safety valve for releasing the angst of conformity and the anxiety of non-conformity. Fiction laid bare the turbulent, conflict-ridden mindscapes of these women, their dilemmas and questioning there that underpinned an apparent attempt to adhere to social expectations and norms. Conformity was not spontaneous, but often a conscious strategic exercise undertaken to conceal subversive psychological processes that in any case manifested themselves in their fictional self-articulations. Now, the hegemony of the dominant patriarchal constructs of womanhood were thus assailed and challenged through the modalities of literary self-exteriorization, creating doubts about the widely held perception that most women in colonial Bengal passively accepted the hegemonic constructs of womanhood so zealously upheld by a nationalist patriarchy. Thus, I will say that মেয়েদের অন্তরঙ্গ সম্পর্কে মেয়েদের যে আবেগ অনুভূতির জায়গাগুলো, মেয়েদের যে অভিজ্ঞতার জায়গাগুলো, সেগুলোকে ধরতে হলে, সেগুলোকে সেগুলোর কাছে পৌঁছতে হলে আমাদের আমাদের কিন্তু যেটা ফর্মাল অফিসিয়াল আর্কাইভ তার ভরসায় থাকলেই হবে হবে না। আমাদের এই এগুলোকে আমরা নন কনভেনশনাল সোর্সেস বলি, সেই সোর্সেস গুলোকে এক্সপ্লোর করতে হবে। এবং হ্যাঁ, ডায়েরিজ, নোটবুকস, অটোবায়োগ্রাফিস, মেমোয়ার্স এগুলো তো বটেই, এমনকি ফিকশনকেও, মানে গল্প উপন্যাসকেও কিন্তু আমরা আমরা এই মনোজগতের মানে যে দরজা আছে, দরজার খোলার একটা চাবি হিসেবে ব্যবহার করতে পারি। আর আরো অনেক কিছু বলার মানে ছিল, মানে যেমন মেয়েদের উপন্যাস থেকে, যেমন আমরা যদি ইন্টিমেসির মধ্যে ভায়োলেন্সের একটা যদি ছবি পেতে চাই, ভায়োলেন্সের ইতিহাস লিখতে চাই, তাহলে কিন্তু আমাদের ওই সোর্স হবে ফিকশন। কারণ অন্য কেউ আত্মজীবনী নয়, আর অন্য কোনো ধরনের, অন্য কোনো যে সেলফ রাইটিংস এরও যে বিভিন্ন ধরন আছে, সেখানেও কিন্তু এই ভায়োলেন্সের কথাটা আসেনি। মানে প্রেমও যেমন আসেনি, হ্যাঁ, বা প্রেমে আঘাতের কথাটাও যেমন সেভাবে আসেনি, তেমন এই হিংসার কথাটাও কিন্তু একেবারে আসেনি, একেবারেই আসেনি। তো তাহলে again we have to fall back on fiction to get a glimpse of the kind of violence, the everydayness of violence in intimate relations in the colonial era. So I think the discussion could go on and on, but I have to stop somewhere. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much for such a passionate and poignant lecture. It not only opened up large areas of thought for us, the idea of finding new sources, which can be new ways of archiving or accessing materials, but also the movement of history towards literature in a certain manner, where in literature, at least, we have the movement called New Historicism, where the confluence of literature and history is very, very specially marked. There can be yes. huge discussions, and we have questions, ma'am. So I'll offer you the first question, which has been asked by Dr. Amit Day. So, she was the first questioner amongst all the participants. So the question for you, and it's a comment, it's an observation also. His question is, what are the differences in experiencing conjugality involving Bengali and British women during the period of your study? Thanks for an intriguing discussion.
Okay, between British women and Bengali women?
Yes, okay. Yes.
We tend to think that Bengali men and women in the 19th century were inspired by the Victorian ideals of companionate marriage, of a romantic conjugality. And yes, it is true to some extent that Bengali couples, they imbibed this concept, they accepted this concept of romantic companionate marriage. But I think my own research reveals that yes, companionship was certainly a new dimension added to the existing notions of conjugality. But there was an obsessive emphasis in this period on the traditional Hindu ideals of Sotitva and Patibrata. Okay, on chastity, on fidelity, on unconditional surrender and subservience to husband. Okay, the fact that that marriage was something which was made by the gods, and that marriages are made in heaven, and a marriage was indissoluble. Okay. There could be no divorce, and even after the legalization of widow remarriage was looked down upon, just because of the fact that a widow also was expected to remain committed to her first husband, even after the husband's death. So, there was an obsessive emphasis on this fidelity, chastity, and something qualities that would defy death, that would transcend death. Okay. So, and I think that is what sets Hindu conjugality apart from, say, Western conjugality. And also the emphasis on the non-consensual character of Hindu marriage. Okay. This exposure to Western literature, exposure to Western romance, premarital courtship really did not gain much acceptance. I mean, yes, lovers, people did, men and women did fall in love, they did marry, but the dominant ideology remained one of non-consensual marriage that would be arranged by guardians. I mean, the marriage was supposed to remain the prerogative of guardians. Okay. So premarital romance, courtship, these were not considered Indian. These were not considered something part of Indian tradition, of Hindu tradition, even though we did have Gandharva marriage, we did have Swayamvara marriage in ancient India, in early India. Okay. So there were some very broad differences between the Western kind of conjugality, the Western conception of marriage, and the Hindu conception of marriage. And let me say that the Brahmo ideal of conjugality did not very, very, very significantly depart from the mainstream Hindu concept of conjugality. There were only superficial and a very cosmetic kind of differences.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your answer. We have two more questions, and that sort of wraps it up. I'm bundling both the questions together, though they are very different categories. The first question is asked by Tonmoy Day, Assistant Professor, Department of History, Krishnanagar Government College. His question is a bit longish, but the final one is a very short and brief one. When women like Taslima Nasreen unmasks the real character of patriarchy, as well as religious rigidity, why do they meet situations like the situations they have met now? Can we make a way out of it? Can we find a way out to save women from this kind of evil? I'll be happy if you enlighten us with your views. This is question one. And the second question asked by Rajoshi Chakraborty is, how far oral history can be an important source in writing women's history?
Of course, oral history is a very, very important source of, yes. I did not discuss oral history, but I think oral history could be a very important source of women's history. You rightly pointed this out. And in my next, I mean, when I set to further develop this paper, I will definitely have a discussion on oral history. Thank you, Rajarshi. And with regard to the first question, I really did not get your question. I mean, Taslima Nasrin ke tumi ei prosonge tonmoy am tumi Krishnagar Government College e acho tumi thik ki prosonge tumi ei alochonar moddhe Taslima Nasrin ke anle tumi ektu ar ektu bolbe mane ami actually prothomei bole dicchi je ami muslim meeder je antor jagot seta ni alochona korchi na karon ami ha Taslima Nasrin er kichu kichu lekha porechi kintu ami oi Rokia chhara ar karo mane sherokom ar kono muslim mohilar lekha porini to oder niye ekta khub alada alochona hote pare ar thik mane ami tomar proshno ta ami thik bujhlam na pore tumi amake jodi janao ইমেল করে তাহলে আমি উত্তর দিতে সক্ষম হব মনে হয়। হ্যাঁ, তবে ঠিক এই আলোচনার পরিসরের মধ্যে তাসলিমা নাসরিনকে আনা যাচ্ছে না আপাতত। হ্যাঁ, এই বলার আছে। আর ওকে
বলুন বলুন, ম্যাম, জাস্ট গো অন, আই থিংক ইউ ওয়ান্টেড টু সে সামথিং।
না না না, ইটস ওকে, আমার আর কিছু বলার নেই, ইটস ওকে, আই থিংক আই এম ডান।
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. De. Thank you, Dr. Bandopadhyay. I mean, it was absolutely scintillating sessions. Now we have to close everything as such. And hence, I request our teacher in charge, Dr. Shukti Shaharoy, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening. I, on behalf of Surendranath Evening College, like to thank all of you present in this one-day national-level webinar organized by the Department of History and IQSC of Surendranath Evening College, titled Perspectives of Indian Women from Medieval to Colonial Time. Today, we are very happy to have with us two eminent speakers, namely Dr. Amit De from Calcutta University and Dr. Aparna Bandopadhyay from Diamond Harbor Women's University, to throw light on this topic. I like to thank all the faculty members of the History Department for choosing such a topic focusing on Indian women on different aspects of life, which is very relevant for today also. We are very much enriched with the informative speeches given by our two eminent speakers, and so I convey my heartfelt thanks to both of them from all of us. I also like to thank our IQSC coordinator, C. Devopriyo Shannal, and Dr. Averi Guho and Dr. Himadrinath Shaha for technical support. I also convey my thanks to all the governing body members and all the teaching and non-teaching staff of our college for their constant support and cooperation. Without them, it is impossible to host a webinar like this in this pandemic situation. I am grateful to all of you participating in this webinar for your cooperation, and believe that in future, you also cooperate with us like today. So please stay at home, stay safe, and maintain, keep social distancing. Let's hope for a better tomorrow. With these few words, we have come to an end of this today's webinar. Thank you all again.
Thank you.
Thank you, madam. So it ends, and thank you all of you. Thank you so much.